Hello, Erica. I think you're on mute.
Yeah, I just.
No. Did you see the agenda I sent you?
Yes, and I sent it to Catalina.
All right, cool. Did you see that other Zoom I wanted you to set up for me? Oh, I sent it earlier, like at 6 o'clock.
Okay, I'll look at it now.
And then I updated all those letters. As well. Who else logs in as Coral Gables Chamber?
I'm doing it right now.
Huh?
I'm doing it on the other end right now.
Oh, so you're doing two?
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah, so I was wondering that this morning. It looked funky.
Yeah, well, because we were trying to figure out how to I was trying to muted near Deirdre. So I'll just help you on this end.
Do they have any slides or anything that need to be shared?
Yeah. So can you do me a favor? Since you logged in before me, I'm going to need you.
Log out?
No. Don't log out.
Can you guys hear me?
We hear you.
Okay, good. Good.
Okay.
We're just doing a little ministerial work here.
That's fine.
I can log back out though, and you can be the host.
You want me to do that?
If that's
so I can give the speakers co-hosting opportunities.
All right, so you might have to log out too.
Did I log out too or no? I'm okay.
No.
All right, I don't know if it'll let me do it, if it'll make me go to. Because it says end meeting and I don't want to end it. So
can
what do you
just
okay. Share a screen or anything?
You'll just have to give the three speakers co-host.
All right, so just tell me how to do that. Hi, Cynthia. I think you're on mute.
Yeah, everybody should be coming in muted.
Oh, okay. I see Jeff. All right, so just tell me what you need me to do and I'll do it. Do they need co-hosts or they can just be unmuted?
I'm messaging you.
Yep, I pulled up Cynthia, so I'll make her a host.
Yeah, and then the two other speakers.
I'm not sure they're on as of yet.
But no, but once you get on, you can do the same that you did with Cynthia.
Okay.
And then they should be able to go down to the bottom and share screen.
Yeah, I see that option. So they can put their files up. Okay, so I'll wait for Christina Ashby and I'll wait for Juan Castro. Oh, I see Juan.
I think Castro's on.
I'm not getting, I went to the bubbles and I'm not getting.
Hey, this is Juan Castro, can you hear me?
Hi Juan, how are you? We can hear you.
Good. So I was just hearing you, do I need to do anything to share my screen?
Hi, this is Erica. Yeah, so Mark is gonna be able to add you as a co-host.
Okay.
And then you'll be able to share your screen.
Perfect, perfect, okay.
So I went to his profile, Erica, and it's not giving me as many options as Cynthia. So maybe I have to do it one at a time.
Yeah, can you go check on Cynthia and then come back?
Yep. Oh, so it pinned her video.
How many participants
are you all? It's not letting me unhost her. So let me go. All right, so I'm going to reclaim the host. And then, hi, Cynthia. You're on mute at the moment, but that's okay. And then I'm going to go to Juan. Juan, are you gonna go first? Because I'll make you the host first.
Yes, okay. Yes. I've got the first few slides, and then I can. So it's not too convoluted. When Christina gets on, I slide. So she has a few that I can then go through and control for her. So we have one person controlling us.
Okay, I have made you the host, so you should be able to go to the bottom and. Use that green arrow to share your screen.
Ah, I see it. Okay. So I'll just wait till after you introduce, right?
Right. You're live now. Okay. I don't know what Cynthia's eating, but it looks amazing.
It's yum.
Cynthia, first of all, I'm so happy you put your proclamation behind you from the chamber. Now, if it's not there every day, you don't have to admit to that. You're still muted. So if you're saying wonderful things. And for those that are listening, we're going to get started here in just about a minute or two. We're expecting a little over 50 participants, and right now we're at about half. So we want to give folks a few moments. And I see Christina has joined. Welcome, Christina.
Just a reminder, everybody's automatically on mute. If you have any questions for any of the speakers, please use your chat option, and we'll be reading those along.
Cynthia, are you at home? Oh, you're on mute, by the way, so I'm trying to read your lips.
Yeah.
Cynthia and I are neighbors. I don't know if you all know that.
No, I'm in my office this week. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You sound great. And I know Carolina Rendero has joined us. And one of our other speakers, Christina Ashby. Jeff, how are you? Looking good. Your office is very organized.
Can everyone hear
and
me?
I know that we're being joined by our Economic Development Director, Julian Perez, has joined us. Michelle Gonzalez, we spoke via email earlier today. Lots of other great folks, so thank you. Get started in just a few moments. And Juan, you're okay, right?
Yeah, I'm all good. Okay. I'll share the screen as soon as you're ready.
All right, excellent. I'm gonna turn on my video. Oh. Oh, goodness. Oh, look, there's all kinds of stuff there with chamber stuff behind it. I don't know what the other one is. That looks like the gem plaque. What do you think, Erica? No, that's their old trustee plaque.
Now the gems are still at the office.
Yeah, the gems have piano finish. And then I see like a George Merrick face. Julian, I know you're on mute, but hello to you.
How are you, Mark? How's it going?
We're doing well. Thank you so much. How are
No, thank you so much for the invitation.
Oh, you're very welcome. For those that are just joining, we're just waiting a couple of moments. We're expecting about 50 or so people, and right now we're at about 30 or so. So.
Good afternoon. This is Joanna Ruano and Brian Ruano with Great Power Learning.
Great. Great to hear from you guys.
Hello, hello.
Fantastic. We love our friends at Great Power. It's got to be interesting times for all of you.
Oh, certainly has been. I mean, it's not without its challenges. Going virtually over a three-day period has been quite the endeavor.
I imagine. And Andy, who is that with you, Andrea? You have to unmute.
This is Simba. Simba's very interested in hearing all about, hi Cynthia, and hearing all about this, so he's ready to.
Well, no doubt about that. Deirdre Nero looks like she's making lunch, so I hope it's something delicious. Hello, Francesca, we've got to get you a piece of artwork for that wall. Michelle, I love yours, beautiful. Renee, welcome back. Hope you had a good morning. We had a call this morning with our global affairs group, so that was great. And good to see many of you. I know some of you are just on phone or just logged in, so we don't get to see you, but I hope you're feeling healthy. We have been working remotely for almost 3 weeks, so everybody is connected in lots of different ways, and these Zoom calls have been a wonderful lifeline. So we're about at 34 now. So we'll just wait another minute and then we'll get started because we just want to be respectful of everyone's time. And I know many of you are probably doing like Zooms back to back. I actually was on a call this morning with the British American Business Council. They did a whole webinar on the planned UK-US trade agreement. That's something that will be once we're into a period of recovery, it'll be front and center. That is a priority of the administration. So very interesting to hear about that and what is planned. You know, it used to be part of the EU, and obviously post-Brexit, we now have to have a bilateral agreement back with the UK. So wonderful. And Norma, welcome to Norma English, my good colleague from Hallandale. They're going to be hosting a webinar also with our friends at City National Bank. So thanks for joining us as well, Norma. It's great to be with a colleague. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and begin the program. It's about 2:06. And again, we have committed to be with you and get through all of your questions after the presentation by Cynthia Wan and Christina. I'm Mark Trowbridge with our Coral Gables Chamber of Commerce. Welcome to our Your Chamber Cares program and webinar on the CARES Act and the Paycheck Protection Program. I know many of you are very eager to hear more about that. Great to have so many of you that are our members and partners joining us today. We have a full slate of Zoom-based programs that we have been producing over the last week or so. And so I hope that not only will you stay with us today, but join us on Thursday when we have one of our members, Will Dukes, present a program at noon that you can register for complimentary that focuses on your brand and how you can advance it during the shutdown. So please make note of that. That's on Thursday the 9th at noon. So just by way of a little bit of background, City National Bank is also our Chambers Bank. We have been with them for a number of years. Cynthia Urena, who you'll hear from, is our personal banker and a wonderful partner and member of our board. But I also wanted to tell you a couple of things. So they reached out to us about a week ago through their team. And so we are thrilled that we've been able to come together and put this program together. And of course, their kind offer to walk you through the Payment Protection Program, CARES Act, and all the various pieces. And then I think secondly, what you should know is they also reached out to us directly and said, listen, we're going to help you shepherd your own application through this process. And so that is the magic of relationships and partnerships and having resources that are front and center, and folks at this time are just wonderful and generous in their ability to reach out and be a great advocate for us. So for us, just keep an eye on the programs that we're doing, keep an eye on our social media. We're trying to spotlight so many of our members that are still operating essential businesses, especially many of our restaurants who are in very much need of your support. So again, I think the biggest thing is that today is really about getting you information. We'll leave time for questions at the end, which we'll moderate. You can use the chat function. You can look at the bottom of your screen and it says specifically their chat with a little bubble above it, and that will line up on the right-hand side of your screen. And so we can also keep track of that. I will help do that. And that will be our program. So it's my pleasure now to introduce three of our great colleagues from City National Bank, Christina Ashby, Cynthia Urena, and Juan Castro. And I'm gonna hand over the hosting duties now to Mr. Juan Castro. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Juan.
Hey, how are you? Nice to meet you all. First of all, just want to say thank you for letting us be a part of this. We have, as I'm sure you've heard, as one of the national banks and one of the only one based out of Coral Gables, we are working very hard to help our community, the companies based in our community, get through this pandemic. And one of the very strong and beneficial programs is the Payroll Protection Act. That's part of the CARES Act. So I'm gonna walk you through what City National Bank is able to do, what the payroll protection program looks like. Christina Ashby works for City National Bank, and she has been our SBA specialist for almost 5 years. So her knowledge has become critical in the last few weeks as this has been enacted. And then of course, you all know Cynthia Urena, who has been with City National Bank probably more than 10 years now, I believe. So I am going to take you through this presentation, and then we're going to have, I think, time for questions afterward. So this is all about getting yourselves ready, and the time to act really for the CARES Act and the Payroll Protection Plan is now. And there we are, myself and Christina. Christina will go over the EIDL program after I talk about the Payroll Protection Plan. So what is the Payroll Protection Program? This was passed last Friday and enacted as legislation. So it has only been about 96 hours since this was passed, and a lot has happened since then. There's a lot of guidance from the US Treasury and the SBA that comes out daily. We had more come out last night about 10 p.m. So what the payroll protection package, the payroll protection program is it is part of the CARES Act. It is a $349 billion allocation, which is being distributed by banks that are SBA direct approved banks to disperse the funds to affected companies in the United States. So the specifics for the use of funds are to cover the costs that companies in the program have for payroll, insurance, mortgage interest, and utilities. And I'll go through specifically what that means. A term you'll hear me refer to is the covered period. And that specifically is a period that the legislation has determined is the time during which there will be a coronavirus impact on businesses. And that's from February 15th to June 30th of this year. The funding is calculated, the loan amount, let's put it that way, the loan amount that this program will provide is based on a specific calculation, and I'll go through it right now. It's the lesser of the average of monthly payments for all payroll costs during a one-year period, and what we've determined that one-year period for almost all borrowers is January 1st to December 31st of 2019. So we take the average of monthly total payroll costs during that one-year period, and you multiply the average monthly by 2.5. So that number or $10 million, whichever is the lesser, is the eligible loan amount under this program. It is specifically focused on small to medium sized enterprises, businesses, and it also includes sole proprietors and the self-employed. It is specifically geared toward companies with 500 employees or less, but there are some very, very important exclusions from that. And those exclusions are in any company that is in the NAICS code of 72, which is industry code that includes accommodations, restaurants, franchises, essentially any food service or lodging companies. The payroll, the total employee test is per physical location. So if you know of employer companies that are greater than 500, but they have multiple locations and they are a restaurant or a hotel, that employee test of 500 is per location. So that opens up the funds to much larger enterprises. In addition, if the business that's looking for the loan is a franchise, there's typically affiliation rules in terms of how the number of employees is aggregated. But for this loan program, those affiliation rules do not apply. So what is the purpose of the payroll protection program loans is, number one, to retain or rehire workers, maintain the payroll, help companies pay their mortgage interest, pay their rental or lease payments, or to make their utility payments. The conditions of the program, and which are extremely beneficial to borrowers, to these small and medium sized businesses, is that all loans under this program will require no personal guarantees. There's no prepayment penalty if the loan is prepaid prior to 2 years. There is no credit elsewhere test. And that's one that, unless your business has gone through the SBA before, you wouldn't be too aware of this, but it is a major hurdle in other SBA loans that the applicant and the bank have to be essentially the lender of last resort. You know, that there is no credit elsewhere available. This program has waived that. So it is available to anyone, no matter what their credit circumstances are. The maximum maturity of the loan will be 2 years. And then we get to an important part: for any portion of the loan that is not forgiven. And we'll get into the very important part about this, about how any loan balance up to 100% of the loan can be forgiven. There is no collateral requirement. That is, means that the loan to any business under this is unsecured. And the presumption and the borrowers under this, the companies, will have to attest to that they have been adversely impacted by the coronavirus. And from what Cynthia and Christina and I have seen, pretty much every business is being impacted in some way. So payroll costs, that this has become a very sticky situation. Different accountants, payroll companies, CPAs, all have differing slight opinions of what payroll costs are. To be included in the calculation of the loan amount that's eligible. So payroll costs, this is the number that is used to come up with the loan amount, is any salaries, wages, commissions, tips, accrued or paid vacation, family, medical, sick leave, any allowance by the company for separation or dismissal, healthcare benefits, retirement benefits, state and local taxes. Now, one thing I'm going to change on this, because this changed yesterday evening, you can now move federal payroll taxes from the do not include up to the include. There was a ruling that we got last night that the intent of the act was for federal payroll taxes to be included. So that on our PowerPoint, which is hasn't been updated in 8 hours as we're doing this constantly, but federal payroll taxes are now included in the gross amount. Payroll costs that you do not include is any salary or compensation for an individual above 100,000. So you don't take that total out, only any amount of salary only above $100,000. Any compensation to employees whose principal residence is outside the United States is not included. And then any qualified sick leave for which credit has been given under a different part of this act would not be included. But those are not, there are not too many of those that we have seen right now. So loan forgiveness. This is a...
Juan?
Yes, yes.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but you brought up a very important point.
Yes.
About something that changed in the last 24 hours.
I'll go back.
Yeah, one of our folks asked me to ask you if they have already applied under the PPP, but didn't include those federal payroll taxes, should they go and fix that, or what should they do?
That is a question that's tough to answer right now.
Okay.
We have been, but I'm going to give you my best guidance. I guess it depends for the individual company, how much does that change the loan amount? Obviously, it'll be larger, but you know, a judgment needs to be made. Is it worth seeking a modification to the approval? So I guess the first question would be, if your application has not been processed and approved by the SBA, yes, definitely try to get it in and amend it and change the application. If it has already been submitted and approved, that's where you need to make a judgment call based on the amount that it'll change, because what we're learning, and I think you probably all are seeing, is that these funds are on a first come, first serve basis. So what we at City National Bank are doing is processing as many of these as quickly as we can. And I can get into the commercial later about how we've been doing that. But if you have a place in line, you know, you can seek it to change it. But since this happened such a little time ago, we are not completely sure about how that happens. Do we need to retract the approval and you lose your place in line and then we immediately, you know, submit another one? Or is it possible through the SBA to modify an approval? That's the part that we're trying to get our arms around. And as you can imagine, with banks that are all doing this, the SBA is concentrated on getting availability through their online portal to get these done. We haven't been able to really formalize how that modification would be done. So I guess the best answer would be, it depends, really. If it's a substantial enough amount for a company, then we would advise you to, and we hope we are your bank, to reach out and we will try to determine what's the best way to do it. You know, pulling your approval to resubmit, that you know, could be a risk just because funds are being used up very quickly now that some of the larger banks have gotten their act together and are now processing. We got a jump start on it and got thousands of applications for our clients in, and we continue to do that. But again, that's a kind of one-off conversation for each borrower under this to think about and see how to weigh it for themselves.
Okay, and then just a follow-up related to that, the question was, are federal payroll taxes the employer's responsibility of Medicare and Social Security? I think I understood that correctly.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, that is correct. So whatever the company has paid into the tax is not what the employee has paid.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. So I'm going to go ahead. We can take more questions at the end.
I'll keep the other ones noted as well.
That's fine. So we'll go to the next very, very important part of this is the loan forgiveness. So we believe at City National that the intent of this program really is that borrowers use the funds to retain workers and to pay the other eligible costs. So I believe that the intent completely by the federal government, Congress, is that as a very, very high portion of these loans will be forgiven. And any loan amount that qualifies for forgiveness will be tax-free forgiveness. There will not be a 1099 issued next year for loan forgiveness that you have to pay tax on that. So how will that amount be forgiven? After the loan amount is processed and disbursed, the following 8-week period after that disbursement, it is going to be very incumbent upon the borrowers to keep track of all payroll costs that are then subsequently paid as of for the entire 8-week period after the disbursement of the funds, for mortgage interest paid, for all rent paid, and for utility payments paid. That number over that 8-week period will become the amount of the loan eligible for forgiveness. One caveat to that, and this came out as part of the weekend update to the documents, is that the government now wants at least 75% of that 8-week total to be spent on payroll, since this is a payroll protection program. So in the 8 weeks after the loan is disbursed, a borrower will then put together all the documents and submit it to their bank and seek forgiveness for whatever portion of that loan, of the loan proceeds, are eligible to be forgiven. What is also going to be very important to show evidence of is that once that amount spent in the 8 weeks is shown and is eligible for forgiveness, the borrower must also show that the total employees they have on the payroll at June 30th is as compared to the total payroll they had at February 15th. So if one of the businesses that borrow had 100 employees on February 15th, and they had at least 100 employees on June 30th, they are eligible for 100% of the calculated amount to be forgiven. It is a sliding scale, though. So if on June 30th, the borrower has only been able to rehire or keep 90 employees, they would be eligible for 90% forgiveness of the amount they calculated. So it's a two-pronged test. It's a bit cumbersome, and the SBA intends to provide the exact calculations and documents for that calculation during the 8 weeks after loans are disbursed. But we are letting our clients know, keep meticulous records after this 8 week period, keep all the evidence, make sure you're tracking everything, because those are going to be the items that you're going to have to show in order to be forgiven of these loans. So the documents that we are asking our clients to gather up put in an application for the PPP program is to give us a payroll records for all of 2019, and then also through February 15th of this year. Keep track and give us evidence of the number of employees they had at year end and then February 15th. Make sure to give us the exact NAICS code, your industry, that you can find it on your tax return. That's been an item that probably 10% of our applications have not had a correct or a full NAICS code, and that is kicking them back to us. And we have to then, we're not just rejecting them, we are reaching out through bankers like Cynthia to call our clients, get the number, and we are inputting it manually, but it is slowing down the process and obviously pushing clients down in their waiting list on the line. So we want to make sure everybody is filling that out completely. We are going to need a copy of the IRS 940, which is the payroll return, 941, which is the quarterly federal tax return of payroll, a payroll summary, a W-2 summary, and then a listing or a breakdown, some sort of calculation that shows any employees over $100,000, how you have deducted that from the total loan amount. So some questions you may have is, do I qualify for a loan? And we walked through that. You qualify if you have fewer than 500 employees, but there are the exclusions that I talked about. What type of loans? We think that applying for the PPP loan is very, very time critical. And so we think that should be first right now. And then Christina is going to talk about the EIDL, which if you qualify, you should be looking at as well. The benefits of this loan is that the eligible expenses that you use after the loan is disbursed can be forgiven and canceled. And we, you know, invite you talk to Cynthia, or if you know another City National Bank banker through the chamber, talk to them, but reach out to Cynthia. And we are processing the PPP loans as I speak. I will give you a little bit of the commercial side. You know, when this was enacted, I think it was overnight between Thursday and Friday of last week, we put a war room together by 2 p.m. on Friday, and we have been processing loan applications since then, 24 hours a day for our clients. We've had our employees working obviously remotely. Cynthia, I think, is the only one who's in the office that I know of. I just saw her on the webcam. We have had up to 100 of City National's 800 employees working simultaneously, inputting into ETRAN, which is the SBA portal, which is essentially a manual process to input all the data that I just went through that you need to provide the bank, and then inputting it directly into the SBA's portal. So it is a time-consuming process, but we have, I think as of just before I came on the phone, we have input almost 5,000 applications for our clients. And we will continue to do so 24 hours a day until our clients get all of the applications they have put in processed, or until the $349 billion runs out. You know, we have heard anecdotally that Wells Fargo has put a cap and they are not taking new applications. Bank of America is, but we do quickly expect that those funds will be used through in a matter of days, if, you know, weeks, if not days. So with that, I'm yes, sir.
I'm going to stop you just for 1 second because I do have a few questions before we get to the EDO loans.
Okay.
So I'll just kind of go in order. A question that says, we prepared our application for the PPP over the weekend through our bank with whom we have our business accounts. And I'll name the bank. It was Wells Fargo.
Okay.
And then they learned yesterday that Wells Fargo is no longer accepting applications.
Yep.
But it seems to be a criteria for banks for applicants to have a pre-established business banking relationship, and they want to know, are they out of luck to apply at all for the PPP loan at this point?
They are not, because they know myself and Christina and Cynthia. So that specific question, I would tell you that a business owner call Cynthia. We are accepting applications for non-customers with the one caveat that they open a new business account with us as part of this, and Cynthia can start that process immediately because we want them to be a customer going forward, but they do not have to be a pre-existing customer. We will accept the application. We have an online DocuSign portal, and that goes right into our system, and I'm the wholesale credit executive, and what we are doing, as I said, is we have our entire credit team in place 24 hours a day. So as soon as we get it, we are putting it in the queue and we're inputting it.
Okay, thank you. Next question. Definitely reach out to Cynthia. Next question. Does payroll expense include both full and part-time employees?
Yes.
Great. If your business is not reopened during the 8 weeks since the loan was disbursed, is there an extension to use the funds?
There is not. The intent of the funds is to rehire workers. So, you know, if you are a restaurant, the intention is as soon as you reopen, and we all hope that is going to be sooner rather than later, it's to rehire everyone. So there has been absolutely no discussion or guidance that will be extended, because the full intent of the program is to get companies back into business before June 30th.
Before June 30th, okay. Yeah. Then we have a question that says, this Friday, April 10th, is for sole proprietors. Are you clear of the rules for requirements and documents? Not sure exactly. Renee, if you want to open your microphone. And just be aware, we're getting a little bit of background noise. So if you're just listening in, make sure you're on mute, please.
So this Friday, I understand, is only for, it will start for sole proprietors. So I have been told that it's not clear what documents are required at this stage, or are you clear, you guys are clear about that?
No, you are exactly right. It doesn't, it's not that sole proprietors only after Friday, they are added as of Friday, can begin inputting applications through the banks. We are not, and I'm being 100% clear and honest with our clients and our prospects. That is not clear yet. I would assume we would probably get exactly what we need from sole proprietors maybe tonight from the SBA and their guidance, but as soon as we have it, we will put it on our website and we will know, we will definitely know what you need by the time that the program begins to be open on Friday, April 10th.
Great, thank you. Sure. Next question, if a salaried employee also collects commission, are both wages included as payroll?
Yes.
I thought it too.
Yes. And Renee, if you don't mind, if you would remute. All right, so that was yes.
Sorry.
No worries. That was that question. We were asked about the presentation. Yes, we will share the presentation and we'll make the Zoom seminar / webinar available to you as well. Next question. I have heard on another call that there may be an additional $250 billion to be approved in agreement between Secretary Mnuchin and Leader McConnell, and that is being worked on for as early as this Thursday. So adding to the 349 in CARES Act, potential $250 billion more. I don't know if anybody else has heard that or if you have heard that in the
book. I have heard that again as typically we learn our information these days by emails being forwarded, but nothing official. I have heard through the SBA, the FDIC, simply like anybody else would, that somebody forwarded an email saying that. So I haven't been listening to the news much because we've been working on applications, but I assume as soon as we hear something, that'll be great news for everyone. Until it does happen, we'll just keep plugging through the $349 billion that are allocated now.
All right. And then I think Greg asked, what if you are a sole practitioner that takes quarterly distributions and or commission fees, how do they go about filing?
Yeah, that's a good question that we're waiting on the guidance. As far as what I've seen so far, it is supposed to be salary only and not distributions. Commissions would be eligible, but again, I would wait till we get the specific guidance on sole proprietors and sole practitioners, because that may change slightly as the one for businesses up to 500 people have been changing slightly every day. So I would just keep an eye out for when those specific rules come out. And again, we will publish it to our webpage as soon as we get anything official.
Okay, next question. Do 1099 employees count in the payroll?
Okay, that has been a tricky one. 1099 employees count in the headcount to qualify as under 500, but their salaries, I'm sorry, the 1099 that is paid to them does not count in terms of creating the maximum loan amount that the company is eligible for. So if there are 1099 employees that, or independent contractors, I guess is the better term, they do count in the headcount, but they do not count in qualifying how much your loan amount will be. And that was a specific change and clarification that came out yesterday. And so we feel very sure about that one.
Okay. Next question. Do we include officer compensation in calculations or just wages?
No, officer compensation, yes, but with the $100,000 cap on the salary amount.
Great. Next question. Can we apply more than once? In other words, with our bank and with another lender? Since one might process faster than the other. I understand you can only take the loan once. I'm just talking about getting into the queue in more than one slot.
That's another, you know, a slippery slope. Obviously, anyone can. One of the attestations on the application, however, is specifically attesting to you are not doing that. So our advice would be, you know, go to a bank that you know are getting them through. I'm biased to say we are getting them through, but it probably is not a good idea to do it at more than one bank or non-bank because of that specific attestation that you're supposed to sign.
And then the last question I have for this section is, says 941 for which quarter 2019?
Just to be still, I haven't been asked that question yet. Just to be safe, let's say the four quarters.
Okay. You can continue to post questions in the chat. Thank you very much, Juan. And we'll turn it back over to you and Christina Ashby.
Christina, if you want to go ahead, and Christina is our head of SBA at City National Bank, and she knows all these programs much better than I do. So if you're on, Christina, go ahead with the EIDL.
Okay, can you hear me?
I hear you, Christina.
Okay. Sorry. I was unmuted from my phone, but I guess still muted on the computer for a second. Okay, so I just wanted to, I was listening to everything that was Juan saying, and Juan is absolutely accurate in everything. I just wanted to clarify a couple things. So April 10th is the opportunity for you to apply if you are a sole proprietor or if you're an independent contractor. And so back to what Juan was saying about not being able to include 1099 employees as part of the eligible payroll cost, the intent of that is because they wanted to avoid double dipping, because 1099 contractors are, independent contractors are eligible to apply for the program independently. So ultimately the use of proceeds is for you to go and pay that person. So if they can then apply for the loan on their own, then you would effectively be double dipping because that independent contractor would be getting paid twice. So that was the whole rationale for that. And then there was another question in regards to additional monies that are being proposed by the Treasury. Yes, we did get that information. It has not yet been approved, but the number is actually $200 billion. So just wanted to clarify that too. So those are the only two things that I wanted to clarify. I don't think I can click ahead on the presentation, though, Juan, because it's yours.
I'll do it, Christina. There you go.
Okay.
You just tell me you. Next, so I know when to hit it.
Okay. Okay. So the Economic Injury Disaster Loan is a loan that is being done directly through the SBA. This is not one that is being done with the banks. So I just want to preface that as part of the conversation to say that while I've been very deeply invested in the PPP program because something that relates directly to the bank. And so eligibility and everything along that lines is related to the bank. I am not actively involved in the underwriting process of the EIDL information. So I stay very connected with the SBA and I'll tell you a lot about the program, but I can't really get into details of how they're underwriting it simply because it's done directly through them and it's nothing that we have control over. So one of the things that we've noted is that employers may receive a credit against employment taxes for 50% of qualified wages paid for each employee during the covered period. And this is something that I would advise for you to go to your CPA on. We did do a joint, and not to put any plugs towards any particular CPA, but we did do a joint presentation with Morrison Brown, and they have a lot of great detail around that and how the benefits that you can take from that. So the program was put into place on January 31st, and it's going to run through the end of the year. As of right now, that's the date that's being given to us. I have heard some buzz in the industry about perhaps extending beyond that date. But as of right now, it still stands at December 31st. So they did implement a $10,000 emergency grant. So the loan goes up to $2 million. That's the cap, as compared to the PPP program, which goes up to $10 million. So this program only goes up to $2 million and is truly just a loan. There is no forgiveness aspect to it outside of the emergency grant of this $10,000. You can move to the next slide.
Okay.
And so these loans are at an interest rate of 3.75 for small businesses and 2.75 for not-for-profits. So not-for-profits who typically don't qualify under the SBA program are really getting the benefit of being able to qualify and apply for not only the PPP loan, but also the EIDL loans. The only exception in this situation, and this is specific to the EIDL because religious organizations are permitted under the PPP program. So the only exception is that if you're a not-for-profit that has a religious affiliation, you are ineligible to apply for the program unless you have a school. So sometimes you may have like a not-for-profit organization that's a religious organization that has a school embedded within, and they would then be eligible to apply.
One thing, Christina, since you said that about this, that is specific to the EIDL. The payroll protection correct. Program loans are open to not-for-profits who are religious organizations. So we have seen a lot correct. From churches and synagogues and mosques, and those, it is specifically available, the PPP, not the EIDL, to those religious organizations.
And that's correct. And so the EIDL program essentially has all the same parameters as far as its small businesses as defined under the Small Business Administration with employees less than 500, unless they're deemed small business by another metric per SBA standards. And then it's also the sole props, the independent contractors, and self-employed. So the parameters are still as well, the 500 employees. You can move on to the next slide. I mean, it's the same standards as far as there's, you know, no credit elsewhere is being applied for the purposes of this program. Loans in excess of $25,000 will need to be secured. However, and I'm not sure if that's on the slide, but it's in excess of $25,000 will need to be secured. However, it doesn't need to be fully secured. So what that means is with SBA lending, it's a little unique in that, let's say I want to go and borrow $1 million, but I only have UCC filing that's for accounts receivables that's worth $500,000. What the SBA is saying is, as long as you can give me a UCC filing that says that I have some sort of collateral, it doesn't have to be all the way up to the $1 million. So it's a unique program in that, and the way the SBA works, that it allows you to essentially be under secured or under collateralized. So there will be no eliminations or determination of ineligibility based on the lack of collateral, as long as you can provide something.
Okay. I'm going to go ahead.
Sure. Yeah. So basically it does not have the forgiveness component the same way that the PPP program does, but there is the $10,000 emergency grant that does not need to be paid back.
Exactly. Okay. All right. And that.
And before we get to the questions, I just wanted to relate how the programs can work together, because Juan did mention that you can be eligible to apply for both loans. So it's a little, there's a caveat to that. So the PPP program is intended for specifically payroll related costs. And the idea is to get people back to work so that we can lower our unemployment numbers and get people the money that they need in their hands to be able to live their everyday lives and pay their bills. So it is very geared towards payroll and employees. The EIDL loan is pretty much for everything else. And so that being said, if you did apply for an EIDL loan and have already received your funds, it does not mean that you're ineligible for the PPP program, but it does mean that you'll need to be able to document what was your use of proceeds for that loan, because you cannot use the loan for the same use of proceeds. So let's use an example. Somebody applies, they're a restaurant, and they apply for an EIDL loan, and they use the money to cover all the spoilages of food or inventory or even maintenance of some of their machines or their equipment. And then they decide they want to go and apply for a PPP loan. So the payroll related costs can be covered under PPP, and the other costs could be covered under EIDL, and those two programs would essentially be complementary of one another. So there's no need to refinance. You have the option of putting the loans together into one loan and getting the benefit of having a lower interest rate of only 1%, which is what we have on the PPP loan. However, please keep in mind that the maturity on the PPP loans is only for 2 years versus the EIDL loans, which depending on the collateral and the use of proceeds could go up to a 30-year amortization. So that kind of changes your payment and your cash flow. Now, if you were to use the proceeds for payroll-related costs that essentially would then be covered under the PPP, it is then required that you can't have both loans. You're going to have to use the PPP loan to completely refinance the EIDL loan, and then that money will be eligible for the forgiveness. And so let me then further clarify that if you decided that you wanted to blend the loans together, the use of proceeds under the EIDL loan would not be eligible for the forgiveness component, and you would still have to be responsible for paying that portion of the money back to the bank. So I hope that was clear, but I'm sure I might have some questions around that. But other than that, I think that's it.
Okay. Thank you, Christina. So we will open up for any questions specific to these two programs for Christina or I before we go back to the host and to Cynthia.
Okay. So I have a couple questions in the chat. The first one relates to the EIDL. What is the $10,000 advance associated with the EIDL? I heard it's not 10,000, but rather only 1,000 per employee. Is this true?
My understanding, and again, it's not something that I could give you great detail on, but my understanding is that it's a $10,000 grant. I'm not sure what the parameters are. I do know that if you do get the $10,000 and then decide that you want to refinance that money into the PPP program, that since you've already been given that grant per se, that you no longer would be eligible to take that $10,000 under the forgiveness as well.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I can't better answer your question, but I will say that these loans are being applied directly through the SBA, and a lot of people have had challenges with trying to complete the application process. The district office actually has tons of resources where we have not-for-profit organizations that are helping businesses every day to prepare their application and prepare their package to present to the SBA, and they do that absolutely at no cost. And so if anybody has additional questions, I can certainly point you in the right direction for those resources for you to get help in your application process.
Great, thank you. Next question. Going back to, I think, the PPP, it says, what is the criteria for the applicants who are 1099s?
The criteria.
So we have not, yeah, sorry, I'll let you answer that one.
No, please go ahead, because I'm not sure.
Yeah, so other than the fact that they're 1099 contractors, that's about all we've been given, to be honest. And the directive that was given, so let's backtrack a few seconds and we say, okay, on March 27th, it was approved and put into place. The Treasury released their information on March 31st. That was their first directive, very minimal information. It took a 800-page act and condensed it into a 4 or 5-page directive, which didn't give us much information. The SBA then later came out and rolled out their guidance on April 2nd, I believe was the day, which was Thursday, before we were getting ready to put everything in place. Now, they did say that then independent contractors and sole proprietors weren't eligible to apply until the 10th. And I think my hunch is that they did that because the guidance was not provided. And so they needed additional time to be able to drill down on those numbers. I do know that if you go to the SBA website, they actually have just rolled out interim final guidance 2, but there's no information. So there's a link there. And if I click on the link, I don't have anything. So my guess is that there's more to come. From what I've been hearing in the industry, we will likely have something today, if not early tomorrow. So unfortunately, that's pretty much all we have.
Great. Another question. As a W-2 and commission-based business owner, I do not always collect a check from the commission earned. I can prove their commissions as it is from a sale or a lease of a property. Can that be claimed as income or wages?
Christina, you can correct me, but from what I've seen, since it is looking for wage statements paid, that it would need to have been paid. That would be my top of head guidance. Would you think the same thing, yeah, Christina? Yeah.
Correct. Yeah. Unfortunately, I mean, there's lots of different ways that business owners run it, but ultimately we are being tasked with identifying what are eligible payroll costs based on payroll summaries, W-2s, and the 940 and 941. So if it's not included in there, it would be quite challenging for us to be able to quantify that number, and the SBA hasn't given us any guidance to that. And so ultimately, what they've given us guidance on is to only use those specific documents to verify.
Yep, I agree.
Another question here says, what if you only hired an employee in 2020? A 941 would not be due until April 15th. Can payroll reports be provided instead?
And the answer is yes, we should be getting a trailing 12-month payroll summary. So the 940 and the 941 is our preliminary, you know, documentation. That's probably the easiest to be able to give. But if you have payroll summaries, and we ask that you do the payroll summaries on a trailing 12-month basis, dating with ending date of the covered period, and that would give us a better picture so that we can verify. To be clear, the application is really on the responsibility of the borrower. And so that's why the advice has been to work with your CPAs and work with your attorneys to be able to craft the application to the best of your knowledge and understanding and ability, and present that information to us. And then ultimately, we then use the documentation to be able to support that. So as long as you can support that information, then we should be able to calculate it in there.
All right, thank you. Next question. How will individuals be notified of the status of their EIDL $10,000 grant applications?
That would be directly through the SBA. So again, the application process goes directly to them. I will say, unfortunately, there has been a little bit of a bottleneck because there's so many people applying that we have seen where people are being in queue per se, or being waiting to be underwritten, and it's about a 3-week turnaround time. From what I understand, again, I'm not fully versed on the underwriting concept of it, but they are giving you the 10,000 essentially up front without the full due diligence, and then they'll grant the rest of the funds. So you have to go through the application process, it gets accepted, and the 10,000 comes before the rest of the money to almost serve as kind of like a bridge to be able to get you by until they've gone through the full process to fund.
A clarifying question. It says, please clarify, if you apply for the $10,000 grant under EIDL, it will not become a grant if you apply to the PPP.
I'm not sure I understand the question, but right. I think
Renee, open his microphone. Yeah. To clarify, Renee. Unmute, Renee.
I'm unmute. You mentioned that if anyone applies under the 10K under EIDL, I understood that it could limit the company or the person applying for the loan under the PPP.
I hope I'm understanding, and so I can hopefully clarify it correctly, but ultimately, if you get a grant, you then can't be eligible for the same amount under the forgiveness, because then it would kind of be like double, right? So you can't have the 10,000 already as a grant to you up front with EIDL, and then go and apply for the forgiveness, which you then rolled, you know, money in perhaps and then get additional forgiveness money on that money, if that makes sense.
So that means
really for borrowers to not double dip and get.
I understand the double dipping, but my question is more oriented than I understood that it was will be credited from the other from the PPP because that way you're not double dipping, or that is a misunderstanding.
That it's credited in what way?
That you, if you're gonna get more under the PPP, mm-hmm. That $10,000 that they grant you, well, will be taken away from the grant under the PPP.
Correct. Correct. That's correct.
That is the proper understanding.
Yeah, ask Deirdre as well, Renee. She says that the amount you get through the PPP would then be reduced by $10,000.
Correct. That is why I only want to verify because that is not the way. Sorry, I didn't understand it that way.
I'm
fine.
Sorry.
No. You did fine. It was me. It's more to me than you.
All right, Renee.
Thank you.
I want to go back on mute. We still have time for a couple of other questions. This just came in. I think it's a clarifying question to the previous one. It says, I think you could use the $10K to pay expenses not allowable under the PPP, like salaries over $100,000 or other items not in the list of allowable uses under the PPP.
Correct.
Correct. The intent is so that you're not using this, the use of proceeds cannot be the same. Correct.
So we have time for a couple of more questions. We can either do them in the chat, or we can put them, you can open your mic and ask live. Yes, that's correct. Or the 1099 employees, yes. Okay. If not, I'll ask Cynthia to open her mic and see if there's anything she would like to add, leaving time for some additional questions. Again, we'll make this presentation available, and we will also make the actual Zoom available. Cynthia, if you open your mic.
I actually have a question for Juan. This came from a client. And he's asking me this one. Most of the qualified payroll W-2 is myself, brother, and mother. A few other employees, however, the bulk is 1099, approximately $300,000 in labor costs via 1099. Please confirm that we may use the money from the loan to pay my W-2 employees and 1099 contractors, and we will not be using it for our salaries. Would this help us qualify for the loan forgiveness?
Yes, I believe that it will qualify for the loan forgiveness. It does not qualify, the 1099 part does not qualify for how the loan amount is calculated.
Okay, thank you, Juan. Any other questions that anybody has? I know I've received some messages privately. I can be reached, and I believe my number is on the presentation. I am based out of the Coeur Gables office, and I'll be glad to assist you like Juan and Mark had mentioned, opening the bank account as well as providing the link to process your applications.
And Cynthia, your email, tell us everybody, and I'll put it in the chat.
It's my name, cynthya.urena@citynational.com.
So that is now in the chat for everybody in case you want to make a note of that. You can send an email response. Again, we'll make the presentation slides as well as the Zoom available to participants. We ended up having about 47 folks join us. I had a couple of you write in the chat, thank you very much, appreciate the presentation. Someone shared that they had been on a number of these, but this was the most informative and helpful. So that is a tribute to our partners at City National, but also our goal is to connect you to those who are doing this every single day. As you can see from both Christina and Juan's comments, things are changing even by the day, the hour that they're learning and interpreting as well. So.
And I'm just typing my cell number for everybody to have it.
Oh, hey now.
You up? Sorry, that's funny.
Other questions? It's about 6 minutes past the hour. We've gone just about 1 hour, so I want to be respectful that I know folks are on call sometimes at every hour, but we will continue to use this format. I want to remind you that on Thursday, Will Dukes will be presenting a presentation. He's with Sales Partner Florida on leveraging your brand at this point in time and helping to survive the shutdown. You can still register for that, members and non-members. It's complimentary, and it's at noon on Thursday the 9th. So we'll stick for just another moment. I know that folks are starting to peel off. But for those of you that we could see, you look marvelous. Sometimes you just got to look at folks to make sure they're looking good. You know, they're feeling good and they're looking good. Right? Julian, you're looking particularly handsome.
Thank you.
Deirdre, we saw you this morning, but only with your Bitmoji. So nice to see you. I love the dog one. That's cute. Pia, your headshot's gorgeous. Amy, I'm not sure what's happening with you. You seem a little...
It's like here. I'm typing and I'm all...
Like you're in your kitchen. Is that a tea kettle behind you?
Yeah, I'm in my kitchen.
I'd love to have a really great cup of tea right now. Fantastic. All right. Well, Juan or Christina, any other comments? I know Cynthia made a few.
I think any questions that you have that come up, if you want to do your PPP loan through City National Bank, Cynthia is the right person to reach out to. You now have her email and her cell phone number, and we will get it done for you.
Fantastic. And as I mentioned at the top of the presentation, you know, we are also a client as the chamber, and they worked very, very closely. First, they reached directly out to us, shepherded our team through everything, including on a Saturday. So thank you very much. I think the information is not only informative, but what great a resource and what great service. So with that, ladies and gentlemen,
thank you.
We'll stand adjourned.
Thank you, City National.
Thank you. Looking forward.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Sayonara.